So first, I would like to thank warmly Geneviève and Romain for the invitation. So I'm very happy to be here. One of the reasons is that I like very much to meet new people from new areas of mathematics. So I'm very happy to be here. Geneviève and Romain asked me to do an elementary course on geometric control and its application to dynamics. So first, I will introduce a few notions in geometric control with very, very simple techniques. And then I will present some applications, some possible applications in dynamics, which are related to what has been presented yesterday by Sylvain and Nicolas, namely a way to connect orbits of geodesic flows or a way to prove Planck's lemmas. Okay, so we will see this in a second part. So let me say that I would like to apologize for those who are very familiar with geometric control because it will be very basic. So geometric control is concerned with the study of control system of this form, let's say. Where here x is the state which lives in finite dimension, in Rn or in a manifold of finite dimension, and u is the control. So for instance, you can have in mind a mechanical system on which you can act by a control. So here you have a cart moving on a track. And so if you don't have a pendulum, you just have a linear system, in fact, because you don't have a theta variable. So you just have a linear system. However, if you add the pendulum, the inverted pendulum, then the system becomes non-linear. And so we are interested in properties like controllability properties or optimality properties. So you are given a cost and you would like to optimize this cost. So it's what we call optimal control. We had today two talks about optimal control problems. And you could also look at different, you could address other problems like observability or over different things, okay? So in fact, in my opinion, the two main results in geometric control are first, the boundary-egging maximum principle. So we saw it at least two times today in two different talks. So it is concerned with necessary condition of optimality for minimizing controls. And the second one is what we call the orbit theorem, which is rather concerned with controllability properties. So I won't speak about the boundary-egging maximum principle. I would like to tell you about the orbit theorem. So I'm going to state it. And since this theorem is a bit tedious to prove, I'm going to prove it in a very simple case to give you the idea. So the orbit theorem is the following. So it is due to Sussman and Stepan. Stefan, yeah. In the 70s. So a good reference for this, for instance, is a book that I like very much. So more generally, it is a good reference for geometric control. It's the book by Velimir Djordjevich, whose title should be Geometric Control, I think. So in this book, you can find the orbit theorem with a proof. Okay, so the theorem says the following. So you are given a manifold. Let M be a smooth manifold. Let's say of dimension N. And without boundary. And you are also given an arbitrary family of vector fields, or let's say of smooth vector fields, so I have to give a name to this family, it will be capital F of smooth vector fields. So you can have infinitely many vector fields in this family. Okay. And so you fix some point in M, and you consider what we call the orbit of this point through the family F. Okay, so it is the set of points that you can reach using the flows of some vector fields which are in the family F. So it is some the set described in this way. So this denotes the flow of some vector field Fk, which is contained in F. Okay. So you assume, for sake of simplicity, if you want, that the flow, all the flows, all the vector fields are complete. Okay, so the flows is defined everywhere. If not, you have to assume that when you apply this flow, it is defined. Okay, it is defined locally, so it's not a problem. So you take this, and for any integer k, for any set of real number tk. So here I stress that the TK can be negative, okay? So you can move forward or backward along the vector field FK. And for any vector fields, if one to FK, which are in F. Okay? So this is the orbit starting at x in time zero. And so this set is a connected, immersed, submanifold of M. Okay, this is the orbit theorem. It's a very nice result, which has very strong consequences in control. So
what does exactly the conclusion mean?
I'm going to explain exactly what it means. Okay, so let's start with this. So remarks. First, what means the conclusion? So the conclusion means that so this set is connected. Okay, it's okay. So it will be topological space that will be connected, and that will be an immersed manifold. So it means two things. First, it is a manifold. And as a set, so it is a manifold, and it is contained in M, of course. And the injection is an immersion. Okay? So at every point, so it is a smooth immersed submanifold. Okay? So it has the topology of a smooth manifold. For this topology, this mapping, for the structure of manifold you have here, this mapping is an immersion, which means that for any point of this, if you look at the differential of I at this point, it is injective into the tangent space to the point where you are at M. Okay? So for instance, as you know, if you have one vector field, so if F is a singleton, then you know, okay, so you have one vector field, so you know that you will find here the orbit of the point x from the vector field F, and so it's like a real line, but which is immersed in the manifold. So it can be something like this. It can be something like this. So, okay. Or it can be something like this too. For instance, you have this, and when t goes to infinity, you approach the point, the starting point, in this way, for instance. You see? So there is no crossing, okay?
But can it really be
Here it's open. You see? Yes, you can. You can have this. You cannot have. No, you cannot have, because here you have this. What you can have, for instance, in greater dimension, you can have this in greater dimension, in fact. So, for instance, you can. I will give the example later. So you can have this too. You have a spiral, which goes to some circle, which is invariant, okay, and which accumulates to the circle.
If it's possible, only if you take only one vector, field, you get the trajectory.
Yeah, because if you take one vector field, the problem is. Yes, of course, you can have a spiral. Yes, of course. Okay, so this is the first remark. It is an immersive, smooth immersive manifold. I'm looking for the riser. Okay. Second remark. So it is a smooth submanifold. A smooth manifold. So for any point in the orbit, you have that if you compute the Lie algebra, which is generated by the family F, and you evaluate it at Y, okay, so I'm going to explain if you want, then it is contained in the tangent space to M at Y. Okay, so this means this. It means that you consider. What? Yes, thank you. So it means that you consider the smallest vector space. So this first. So Lie of F is the smallest vector space in the set of vector field on M, which is invariant by Lie brackets with elements of F. It is, if you call it S, then for any vector field, let's call it capital X in S. For any f in f, you have a this vector field is in S. Okay? And all nf is in the set S. Okay? So in this way, you get a vector space. Possibly, and it will be very often of infinite dimension, and then you evaluate this set of vector fields on Y, okay? And so you have this inclusion, and it is due to the fact that, as you know, the Lie bracket of X and Y is this thing at some point Z is up to T square. It's this thing. Let's put T here. Okay, you have this formula. So assume that you are in Rn. Since I'm writing something here, I'm writing a minus. Okay, so it means that if you are at Z, then you follow the vector field capital X direction some time T. So you apply this. Then you get some point, which is exactly this point. Then you follow capital Y during some time t. Then you follow minus capital X during some time t, minus capital Y. Here you have a defect if two vector fields do not commute. And so this defect up to scalar, multiplicative scalar, is exactly the Lie bracket. Okay? So it's clear that if the, by the definition of the orbit, if you can reach a point Z, then you can reach this point, applying this for diffeomorphism. And so since this is a smooth manifold, this Lie bracket will belong to this. Okay? And then you can iterate, and in this way you get that the Lie algebra generated by F is included in the tangent space to O. Okay? So this is the first remark. So as you probably know, in the analytic case you have equality. If a family, if all the vector fields in the family are analytic, if F consists of analytic vector field, then you have equality. And if not, I mean, if they are not analytic, then you don't have necessarily equality. Okay, for instance, the classical example is the following. You are in the plane. You take a family F with two vector fields, F1, F2. F1, you take it at the horizontal vector field, so let's call it dx. Okay. Everywhere, so F1 is like this. It's always the same, it is constant. And F2, you take dy, so the vertical vector field multiplied by some function alpha of x, which is zero on the left on the left of the vertical axis, and which is non-zero here. Okay, so alpha equals zero if x is negative, and sorry, it is a function of one variable. So on the left real line, on the set of negative real numbers, it is zero, and it is no, different from zero if x is strictly positive. Okay? In such a way that if you start from this point, here, so you can follow the first vector field F1, as long as you want, in fact, to go in this area, in this part, in this domain. And when you are here, F2 is the vertical vector field multiplied by something which is not zero. So it allows you to go vertically, so you can move vertically, so you can come back. And in this way, you can fill all R2. Okay? And you see that here, when you are at this point, at any point on the left side, the Lie bracket, the Lie algebra which is generated by F on the left side is just the vector field F1. Okay? So you have a strict inclusion between this and the tangent space to the orbit, which is R2. Okay? So it is typically non-analytic, this function. Okay. So it is the second remark. Fourth remark, as you can see, no, third, two, three. If you have that for any Z in M, you know that the Lie algebra generated by F at Z generates the whole tangent space, then it means that, by the previous inclusion here, it means that you have that T Z O of X is equal to the tangent space to M at Z. So it means that O of X is an open set. Is a connected open set, in fact. So I'm not going to prove the orbit theorem in its full generality. I'm just going to show the following. We are going to assume that we have a finite family of vector field which satisfy this condition of non-integrability. Then we are going to show that the orbit is a connected open set, and in fact, if M is open, it will be the whole M, the whole manifold M. So let's state precisely the result. So to start, I'm going to assume that I am in a very simple situation. So theorem. So I assume that I have a finite number f1, fk of vector fields, smooth vector fields on M. Such that, as before, the Lie algebra generated by f1, fk, at every point, is equal to the whole tangent space. This is my assumption. I moreover assume that M is connected. Okay. Then I'm going to show the following. Then for every pair of points X and Y in M, I can find a function U in L2, let's say from 0,1 to Rk, such that the solution to the Cauchy problem which is this one, so it is a non-linear control system without drift. So I relax my family, and I authorize to do a convex combination of the vector fields F1, Fk. Okay, I will tell you afterwards how to remove this assumption. Okay, so I take the solution of this Cauchy problem. So I fix X and Y. So for, up to now, Y does not appear. So I fix X, I take a control in L2, I solve this system, so I assume that my vector field are complete, for instance, and so I have that X, so the solution, let's call it X of U at time 1 is equal to 1. So that's what I would like to show. Given 2 points in the state space, I can find a trajectory of my control system, XU, which steers the first point to the second point. Okay, so I'm going to prove this result. And then as a consequence, I'm going to show that in fact, I can do this kind of connection just using bang-bang controls. So it means that we could just use either F1 or minus F1. Instead of any U, which is a convex combination of the bang-bang controls. And then I'm going to show different things. Okay. So I must say that the proof I'm going to give is adapted from the one given by Belaish in the book Tangent space to Subramanian geometry. In fact, in this book, you can find a proof of the orbit theorem, so by Belaish, André Belaish, using exactly the same idea. But when you want to prove the orbit theorem, you have to check that the O of X as is a manifold, and so it's a bit tedious to do. You have to. So I prefer to do this case. But the idea is the same. Okay, so let us start the proof. So it's simple. So the proof is based on the notion of non-singular controls. We are going to prove that, in fact, most of the controls are non-singular. And so most of the control can be used to do the job. You will see. Okay. So proof. So as I said previously, I assume without loss of generality, we can multiply the vector fields. So where is my theorem? Ah, okay. Okay, no, it's okay. Thank you. So, without loss of generality, I can multiply my vector field, F1, Fk, by some scalar function in such a way that they become complete. Okay, you multiply them by a function which is flat at infinity, and they are complete. So proof, I assume that they are complete. So it means that the flow is well defined on the real line for any point. Assume that F1, Fk are complete. And so we can define what we call the endpoint mapping. So let us fix x in M. And so let us define what we call the endpoint mapping from the point x in time 1. So it's the mapping which maps a control to the endpoint of the curve that you get when you solve this Cauchy problem. Okay. So it is a mapping defined on L2, valued in M. And so as I said, you take a control U. So a control U is a function of time, valued in Rm, which is L2. And so given a function U, a control, I map it to the end of the trajectory solution of the Cauchy problem, which is there, up there. Okay. So in fact, this mapping will play a crucial role in the proof. You can prove that this mapping has the same regularity of the vector fields. So here I assume that the vector fields are smooth. So you can show that this mapping is smooth. At the moment, we just need, in fact, the endpoint mapping to be C1. So it is C1. It is freshly differentiable at every point. In fact, it is C1. So lemma. So this is C1, so it is smooth, okay. And if you take any control U in L2, you have the following. For any K, no, for any I, so you take any vector field in the family F1, Fk, you look at the vector field at the endpoint given by U, so this, and by definition, this at U. Okay, so you have X, you have your trajectory, XU, you have the endpoint here. Okay, and so you look at the value of the vector field Fi at this endpoint, then it is contained in the image of the differential of the endpoint mapping at U. Okay? So what does it mean? It means that if you have Fi here, let's say it is like this, performing a perturbation of the control U of size delta, you can get a perturbation of the endpoint along the direction Fi of size, something equivalent to delta, okay? So I don't want to prove it, it's easy. What you have to do, proof. So it's natural because you are moving, and so you have, you just have to kick the control in the direction of ui equal 1, and the other control equals 0. So I'm doing a picture. Proof. You can prove the following. Limit when epsilon goes to 0 of this. Equal this. With V epsilon, so I'm sorry, I have to. With V epsilon given by this. So you have a time, the interval 0, 1 here. And so you have to perform a perturbation of U by something like U plus something small times V epsilon. In fact, the small is already in the V epsilon. And so V epsilon is something like this. Up to time 1 minus epsilon, you keep the same control U. And between 1 minus epsilon and 1, you kick U using something of this form, where this is the canonical vector in the canonical basis. Okay? So in this way, on this interval, U will move in the direction of Fi. And so in this way, you will move the trajectory in the direction of Fi. So you can prove this. So to do this, you just have to compute this and to check that you have this. Okay? And so by construction here, V epsilon is in L2. Okay, it's something which is finite. It is bang bang. So this belongs to the image of du. Okay, and so it is the limit. This set is closed. You are in finite dimension. So this is in the image. Okay, and so you are done. Okay. So this lemma will play a very important role. In fact, it is the main lemma to prove the result. Where I should write now? So we keep in mind this lemma, and so we can continue the proof. Lemma number two. So it was lemma one. Lemma two. Lemma two. For every epsilon. So this lemma two will be, in fact, I don't need to show the theorem I have stated. I don't need this lemma in full generality. I don't need to have it for any epsilon. But we will use it to obtain a strengthened version of this theorem. Okay, so for any epsilon, if you define d epsilon by this, it is the maximum of the rank of the differential of Ex1 at U. Okay, so among all the control, so I should say first, among all the control U in L2, such that the L2 norm of U is strictly less than epsilon. Okay, so I take all the control in L2 whose norm is less than epsilon. Then I look at the rank, so the dimension of the image of this differential at U, and I take the maximum. Okay? So I claim that this maximum is equal to n. And I remind you that n is the dimension of the ambient manifold. And so after this, you will see that this lemma 2 will do the job. It will allow to obtain controllability, global controllability, and so to prove a theorem. Okay, so how to prove lemma 2? We act by contradiction and assume that, so we fix epsilon. And so we assume that d epsilon is not equal to the dimension of the ambient space. So it is something like S, something less than n. And so we will get a result using, we will get a contradiction using lemma one, so proof. So if not, then, so d epsilon is less than n. And so d epsilon is also strictly positive. Why? Because we know that we have the assumption of non-integrability on the family F1, Fk, which means that it's not possible to have all the Fi which vanish at a given point. All of them cannot vanish together, okay? So necessarily, by lemma 2, lemma 1, sorry, since the image contains all the Fi cannot be zero together, it means that this has at least dimension 1, okay? So we have this. Okay. So, we can find, so let's call this D, okay? We can find D controls in L2 such that this mapping, so I have to give a name to the controls, so V1, Vd, such that this mapping So I take the mapping, which is defined on RD. In fact, it will be defined on a small neighborhood of the origin, and which corresponds to a perturbation of the control U by the control by a linear combination of V1 and VD. And I apply one-point mapping to this perturbation. So it's this. U plus... So I fix U, okay? So maybe I should say first. So if not, D is bigger or equal than 1, less strictly less than N, and I take U such that rank of U is equal to D. Okay, I need this. Okay? So it is the set of the rank is valued in the set of integers, so the maximum is attained. So I take a U where the maximum is attained, and with U of norm strictly less than epsilon. Okay? So it is U. For this U, there are D controls, V1, VD, such that this mapping is an immersion at the origin. Okay? Because if you compute the differential of this mapping, it will be the differential, the partial derivative of this mapping with respect to lambda I is du of Ex1 at Vi. Okay? And so by assumption, since I know that the rank for U is D, I can do this. Okay? So now, I have an immersion. So the image by this immersion of a small neighborhood of the origin here is a submanifold of M of dimension D. Okay? So there is a small neighborhood. There is a small neighborhood let's call it V of the origin in RD such that the image of V is a smooth submanifold of dimension D in M. I'm sorry, I have to time my... So what we can say now, it's that for any... So let's call this manifold capital N. For any y in capital N, we have that the tangent space to N at y as dimension D and since y is in N, it is the image of some control which is close to U. So it's EXT of U prime, EX1 of U prime. And so this tangent space at y, it's exactly the image of the differential of EX1 at U prime. Okay? We have this. This image is equal to this, okay? And we know that the image we don't need to use that the rank is maximal. We need to use the fact that the rank is maximal because we know that this has dimension less than D. Okay? The rank at U is D. So since the rank at U is maximal, in a neighborhood of U, the rank has to be D. It has to be larger because the rank up mapping is lower semi-continuous, so you can go up. But it cannot be beyond the rank which is maximal. Okay, so you have this equality. In fact, you could have this. Okay, you could have this because here the mapping E just take a small part of possible perturbation. But in fact, you take all of them. All of them which allows to get something. Okay, so you have equality here. Okay, and you know by lemma one, which is here, that all the Fi are contained in this image. Okay, you have this equality, and you know that this image contains all the vector fields Fi. So what you get at the end, you get that for any Y in N, for any I in 1K, Fy, Fi of Y is in the tangent space to N at Y. Okay, so it means that, in fact, your familiar vector field is tangent to a submanifold of dimension which is strictly less than N. So it cannot satisfy the non-integrability condition, which is unfair, okay? So it cannot satisfy this condition, this one. Because since you have this, all the Lie brackets of the Fi are contained in this. So they cannot generate the whole tangent space to M at X. Okay, so you have the contradiction and you are done. Okay? So now we know that the rank is, the maximum is N. So we know that there are what we call non-singular control, a control such that rank, so let's call it U, such that rank of this equal N is called regular, or I prefer to use non-singular at X. So you see that when you take a control, you can apply it starting from any point. So the fact to be regular or not will depend on the starting point of the trajectory. Okay, so I have to stress that it is with respect to X. Starting from X, this control has the property of regularity or of singularity or non-singularity. Okay. So now we would like to, I would like to show how to deduce that that we have global controllability. So I can erase here. No, maybe here. So to show that I have global controllability, I will first show the following lemma. So lemma 3. The endpoint mapping, so for every X, this endpoint mapping is open on L2. In other terms, the image of an open set of L2 is an open set in M. The image U open in L2 implies its image is open in N. For instance, if I apply the control U equals 0 to my system in time 1, so if I apply U equals 0, I have X dot equals 0, starting from X, I remain at X, so the image of 0 by the endpoint mapping is X. So if I take an open ball, a small ball of U equals 0 in L2, its image is a neighborhood of X. So it implies that I can reach some point in a neighborhood of X, so it's what we call local controllability. Okay, so let's prove this result. It's easy. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I need to take an open set and to show that its image is open, okay? And so I'm going to show you how to do it using this. So proof. So let U be an open set in L2. And y equal to x1 of u bar for some u bar in u. Okay. So I have this. I have xu here, and I have y, which is this. Okay. So I want to show that, in fact, there is a small ball here centered at y, such that any point of this ball, in this ball, is the image of some control which is contained in U, capital U. Okay, that's what I need to do. I know from this lemma that for epsilon small, for any epsilon, there is a control whose rank is n, of size less than epsilon. So I take epsilon small, and so I consider U epsilon a control of rank n and size epsilon. Okay. So this control U epsilon gives rise to a trajectory which is solution to the Cauchy problem. So let's call it X epsilon dot. It is solution to the Cauchy problem associated to U epsilon, okay, starting from X. Okay. And so it is something like this. Okay. So a priori, this trajectory is defined on the interval 0, 1. It is defined on the interval 0, 1 by definition. I can speed up the trajectory in order to define it on some interval 0 epsilon. Okay. So I could in fact assume that this trajectory is defined, so it is x epsilon, and it is defined on the interval 0 epsilon valued in n. So what I'm doing now, so it's classical in control, I'm considering this control. Let us consider the control U epsilon concatenated with U epsilon chetch concatenated with U reparametrized. So I explained. I would like to define a control which is defined on the interval 0, 1. Okay, and so as I said, U epsilon is defined on 0 epsilon. U epsilon change, by definition, it is U epsilon change of t equal U epsilon of epsilon minus t. Okay, so the trajectory, so U epsilon steers the point x to some point x epsilon of epsilon. Okay, it is this point. When U start from this point x epsilon of epsilon, if you apply U epsilon change, you get the same trajectory in reverse time. And so after time epsilon, you will reach the point x. And then when you will apply the control u, you will follow this trajectory. Okay, so since I would like to have a control which is defined on 0, 1, I have to reparametrize this control, in fact, to speed up a bit in such a way that this control is defined in time 1. Okay, you see? Because here you need time epsilon to get there, then epsilon, and then you apply your control for time 1, you have time 1 plus 2 epsilon. You would like to have something in time 1, so you have to reparameterize. Okay.
And when you reparameterize epsilon on this small time interval, you change the L2 norm to square root of epsilon, but I guess it doesn't
No, it doesn't matter. And so, you have a control which is defined on this interval, and for this control, the endpoint starting from x is the same because the trajectory is this one. You do this, and then you do this. It's the same. But so we have Ex1 of u. No, what is the name of this control? So it has no name, so it is u tilde. Ex1 of u tilde is equal to y, first thing. Second thing, the rank of this control is equal to n. So maybe I should explain why. You have a concatenation of three controls, and one of them has rank n. It implies that, in fact, the concatenation has rank n. I'm going to do a picture. So imagine that I'm going to do a picture here. You have two. Imagine that you have two controls, and you take the concatenation of two controls. So imagine that you have u1, u2. So you start from a point x. You apply a first control, which is u1. So you get the first trajectory xu1, okay, it is this one, so associated to u1. And assume that this one is non-singular. Then, so you reach this point, let's call it y. Then you apply another control, u2. And then you get the point z. Okay, so when you start from x and when you apply u1 concatenated with u2, you go from x to z. And so I claim that the fact that one of them, u1 or u2, is non-singular is sufficient in order to have that the concatenation is singular, is regular. Why? Because being non-singular means that doing a perturbation of the control u1 at small order, you can reach here a small ball of size delta. So if you do here a perturbation of size delta in the control, you reach a small ball of size delta. And then now, so imagine that you do this, you have at this point, and now you apply the same control, the control u2 starting from here. The Cauchy problem, the non-autonomous Cauchy problem associated with the control u2 leads you, gives you a diffeomorphism from y to z. So in fact, if you apply u2 to starting from this point, you will get a point here. And in fact, the image of this ball by the diffeomorphism given by u2 is a ball, is not a ball, but is a neighborhood of z. Okay? So here you use the regularity to get a neighborhood, and then you keep the same control to send this neighborhood to another neighborhood. Okay? So the trick here is to use the fact that you have small controls which are regular in order to get to the same endpoint, but with a control which now is non-singular. Okay? So now what you do, something else I need to do, it's that when epsilon goes to zero, so I should maybe call u tilde epsilon. When epsilon goes to zero, u tilde epsilon tends to u in L2. Okay? Thanks to the fact that it is the concatenation of u epsilon, which is small in L2, with u epsilon change, which is small, with something which is zero parametrization. Okay? You have this. So in fact, you are able to approximate u by a non-singular control as close as you want in L2. And so now you are done, because for epsilon small, u tilde epsilon belongs to u. You agree with me, because it tends to u in L2 and u is open. So you have this, and this mapping is a submersion at U epsilon tilde, okay? Because the rank of this mapping is equal to n, which is the dimension of the ambient space. So since it is a submersion, you can fill the neighborhood of the image of this. Okay, so it means that you can reach a small ball by some control in L2. Okay, so it means that the mapping is open. Okay, so as a conclusion, by the inverse function theorem, EX1 of U contains is the neighborhood of Y. And so you are done. So a nice way, a convenient way to get the openness of a mapping is to show that the mapping is a submersion. So that's what we are doing. And so you are done. And so now you have the matrix, it's easy to conclude the proof of the theorem. It's classical. So proof of the theorem. So the theorem above, this one. So we fix x in M. And so we denote by A of x, like attainable set, the set of y, which are attainable by some control in L2. Okay. So first, what we proved with the last lemma is that A of x is open, because we show that the point mapping is open. If you have some point y in A of x, y is equal to some EX1 of u, you take a neighborhood of u, the image of this will be a neighborhood of y. So A of x is open. And A of x is closed. By symmetry of the system, so you assume that you have a sequence of points yk that you can reach by different controls, okay, and that it tends to some y, which is here y bar, okay. Okay, so now you know that starting from y bar, you can reach a small ball. In fact, by the first assertion, okay, the attainable set from y bar is open and contain y bar. So it is a neighborhood of y bar. So it means that, in fact, for large values of k, yk will belong to this neighborhood. So it will be attainable from x by some control, this one. And you have also some trajectory which connects y bar to yk, starting from y bar. Concatenating the two trajectories, you get a trajectory from x to y bar. Okay, so y bar is in the attainable set from x, so x is closed. You remember that M is connected, so we infer that x is equal to M, and we are done. Okay, so the last part is very easy. Are there any questions? So the idea which is here has been used by Jean-Michel Coron in the setting of control of PDEs to obtain a controllability result in PDEs, and Jean-Michel Coron calls it the return method. Okay. And so the trick is to find the loop. If you want to show a local controllability property around the point, the trick is to find a loop, the trajectory which goes from this point to this point, which is regular. And so you can apply this trick, and you get local controllability. So remark one, the method is called the return method.
is nowadays called the return method. And so I refer you to the book of Jean-Michel Coron for application of this method to control of PDEs. And so the name of the book should be something like Control and Nonlinearity. I think it is, in fact. Okay. Second remark, in fact, what we proved that in fact the set of control, so given X, we proved the following, the set of control in L2, no, which are non-singular, is dense in L2. Okay, we were able to approximate U by a sequence of control U tilde epsilon, which were non-singular, with the same endpoint, in fact. So in fact, most of the control in L2 are non-singular. So in fact, it is dense, and it is open also. Because non-singular means that the rank of something is n, and this condition is open. So most of the controls are non-singular. The problem is to pick one of them. Okay. Third remark, we can go back to the initial problem. So first, let's do it with smooth control. In fact, we can show that for any pair xy in M, there is a control which is smooth, or analytic, or polynomial, which steers x to y. So always under the assumption of non-integrability of the vector field. So that xu of 1 equal y when you start from x, OK? Why? I'm going to do a picture. So we know that we have controllability by control in L2. And we know that we have controllability by regular control in L2. So let's do a picture. You have X, you have Y, and you have here a control in L2, which gives rise to a trajectory XU. And U is regular. U regular by the inverse function theorem, it means that, in fact, you can find n controls in L2 such that this mapping, the same as before, so it's the same, okay? Lambda gives Ex1 of U plus sum of lambda I Vi is a diffeomorphism at zero, which means in the neighborhood of zero, okay? So since U is regular, it means that the mapping, the differential of this mapping is a submersion, so I can pick n control in L2 such that this is a local diffeomorphism, but the set of smooth control here is dense in L2. So I can take them to be smooth. Okay, so I have this. Now you can quantify this, the fact that you have a diffeomorphism, and you can show that in fact you can reach a ball here whose radius is controlled by this and by the image of a different controls Vi. Okay, what I mean by this is that if you move a bit U here, if you move this, the radius won't move much. Okay, so if you approximate this U, which is in L2 by a control which is smooth, the radius will be almost the same, and so the ball will be almost the same. So the point Y will still be contained in the new ball. Okay? So you will have something like this. Okay, it will move a bit, but Y, which is in the very center, will remain in the new image. So what you do here is that you approximate U by some U tilde which is smooth, and taking U tilde sufficiently close to U, you will have that Y is in the image by some neighborhood of zero here through the mapping E. Okay? And what I'm saying, you can do it with any set of control which is dense in L2. So it can be smooth, it can be polynomial, it can be bang-bang. Okay? So you do the same thing for control which are bang-bang, and you have the result. Okay? Okay, so let us continue. In fact, it's important to say something. We can prove the existence of regular controls. Yes?
If you think of, like, if you look at the free image, if you look at the set of controls,
yes,
which end at y, it seems to be a codimension n submanifold in the space of all controls.
Yes, the problem, it is the set of controls such that the image is y, that's right. That's the, it's not a manifold because you can have controls which are singular. If any control is regular, you have a submersion, so the pre-image is some submanifold of codimension something.
So intuitively, let's say it should be a positive codimensional submanifold, so then it's not so clear why it intersects open sets. I'm not so much convinced.
With this?
Yes.
It's because you're not convinced by the quantitative inverse function theorem.
No, I don't know, but look at this reasoning. The set of good controls is typically a submanifold of positive codimension, so there should exist dense open sets.
Yeah, yeah.
Which do not
exist. But there is not. They should exist. But it is open, the set of good controls. So it is open because it is a condition it is a rank condition on some function which is C1.
Which finish at Y, which reach.
Those which finish at Y.
What you said is that there is a good control.
Okay, so those which finish.
Smooth control which reaches exactly Y.
Yeah.
So, there seems to be for me a contradiction here.
Why?
Because on one hand you have a positive codimensional submanifold of controls which reach y, and on the other hand you say this positive codimensional submanifold intersects any dense open set.
So you have a finite codimension of dimension which reach y. So
maybe I don't want.
No, but for parameterization is not a problem. But no, I don't think there is no contradiction. I don't see why you see a contradiction. Okay, we can speak later. So it was the proof, so which is based on the fact that you have a lot of non-singular controls. In fact, there is another way to prove the existence of non-singular control proposition. So we just saw that the set of regular, I'm sorry, because sometimes I say non-singular, sometimes I say regular, but it's equal, it's the same. So I was saying that here we proved that we have many non-singular controls in some way, but you can prove it in another way, at least for smooth control. So proposition, the set of controls, so there is a residual set in smooth topology, so in this, the set of controls which are smooth on 0, 1 valued in Rm. So let's call this set G, such that for any U in G, for any X in M, U is regular with respect to X. So this result is due to Zontag, Eduardo Zontag. And so he called this kind of control universal. Okay, so there is a control, some function, at least one, so that whatever the starting point, this control will be regular. Okay? And in fact, the set of such control is residual. What? So I said that regular means that. Yeah.
Right.
Not regular is in the sense it is smooth. It is smooth. It is true. Yeah. Okay. So for any x, you take this trajectory for this u. This u is regular. So moving u at first order, you reach something at first order. So in fact, you have this. And so how to prove such a result? When you see such a result, you immediately think of transversality theory. So I'm just going to give you an idea of a proof. Proof, which is illuminating, in fact, for the sequel, proof, we use transversality theory. So you know that transversality theory means that you have some set that you would like to avoid, or you like maybe to intersect it, but in a transverse way. And so generically, when you will cross this set, which is this one, you will do it in a transverse way. Okay? This is the idea. It is based on some theorems. So let's prove it. So it is based on the following lemma. Lemma, we can characterize the singular control. Characterization of singular control. So roughly speaking, we are going to see that to be singular, the control has to satisfy some algebraic condition. And then by transversality, a control cannot satisfy too many algebraic conditions. It's not well said in the right way. A singular control has to satisfy a finite number of algebraic conditions, and generic control do not satisfy this finite number of algebraic conditions. So let's write the lemma. So the control U is singular if and only if there is some absolutely continuous curve psi valued in the cotangent bundle of M, which does not vanish. It is not zero, such that xu, so xu is the trajectory associated to u, okay, so xu is the solution of the Cauchy problem starting at x, okay, so such that psi dot of t is solution to this control system. Such that the projection of psi is equal to xu, and psi of t is always in the zero level set of the Hamiltonian Hi. So I need to explain. Okay. So, if you have something which is singular, I'm going to do a picture. So, downstairs, you have your trajectory in M. Here you have M. So, it is xu. Okay, so it is here the starting point. Okay. In the cotangent bundle here, you have psi. Okay, which project by projection to xu, okay? Psi leaves its solution to this control system. Okay, it's an Hamiltonian control system here. So I have to say what are the Hi. With Hi equal so in coordinates, if you have psi equal xp, hi is equal to this, okay, p times fi at x. So, which implies that the vector field, the Hamiltonian vector field Hi vect at xp is Fi and minus p dFi. Okay? So you have a psi solution to this. In fact, I can write it in this way, psi dot, so which is in fact in coordinate xu dot p dot, which is equal to sum of ui fi of xut. So which tells you that the first coordinate corresponds to the curve downstairs. And the second part is solution to this. Okay, you have this. And moreover, hi of psi is equal to zero for any I, which means that in fact psi of t belongs to the annihilator of the vector field F1 Fk along the curve. Okay. For any t, you take the vector space which is spanned by the vector field, then psi t, it is a linear form which annihilates this vector space. Okay? Since you have this. So in a geometric way, for instance, if you know that the vector fields are always linearly independent, for instance, you have two vector fields which span which generate a plane. So you have the curve is tangent to this field of planes, and upstairs, psi is always orthogonal to these planes. Okay, so you have this. And so, to show that you have that generic controls are singular, are regular, you take one of them, and you write down what it means to be singular, and then you take some derivatives. Okay, so let you. I'm just going to take one to show you what happens. So let U in being smooth such that it is singular with respect to X. Okay? Oui?
You should take a breath.
No, I just need 3 minutes.
Okay,
so I take U, which is singular with respect to X. So from this, I get some psi. We satisfy this and this, okay? So just to show you what happens, I take this formula, okay? So I can take a derivative because psi is absolutely continuous and hi is smooth, so I can take a derivative. So I take a derivative and I will get this. So I just what I will get, in fact. I will get I will get this. So let's say that it is one here. Taking one derivative, I get this. There is a P missing, sorry. Okay, I get that this combination has to be zero. For instance, imagine that one of these coefficients, so the vector fields here are fixed, they do not move. Imagine that this is not zero, this thing. For some I, it is not zero.
X is F, I guess.
Yes. X is F, and so imagine that, for instance, at time zero, for any P which is orthogonal to this at zero, there is some I such that this is not zero. Imagine you have this. Then, a generic control cannot satisfy this. Okay? So maybe this is zero, because imagine, for instance, that you have only two vector fields and the dimension of the ambient space is very large. So it means that you have a lot of room, you have a lot of P which are orthogonal to this. So some of them can also annihilate all the Lie brackets, okay? So what you do, you take a new derivative of this. When you will repeat this, you will get something like this. So you will have something which depends on the derivative of u, plus something that will depend on p times a li bracket of length 3. Here you have three things, okay? And since you know that your vector fields, the Lie algebra, which is generated by the vector fields, span everything, then you know automatically that these things cannot be zero for all Lie brackets. You have automatically some of these coefficients with sufficiently long Lie brackets that cannot be zero. So you will use this to show that generic control cannot satisfy all the algebraic conditions. And so you get the result. Okay? So I stop here, and then after the break, I will speak about application. Okay. In dynamics. Okay.